ओके
मैम, ओनली 5 पीपल आर देयर,
6 अदर पैनलिस्ट, अदर डॉक्टर सिद्धार्थ गुप्ता इज देयर,
या
द पैनलिस्ट, ही इज लॉग्ड इन. वेलकम सिद्धार्थ. And others will log in usually.
Dr. Nandan, menu will be in YouTube. It's because it's easy to join in YouTube. So attendees will be in YouTube mostly.
Okay. Okay.
Siddharth, sir, good evening.
Panelists are here. Okay. So we can start our today's webinar session. In the present one in our series, this is the 6th, 7th one in the series which we are holding successfully. And today's topic is mediator of inflammation, mechanism, resolution. Again, a very basic topic which is required in interpretation and understanding the pathogenesis in our day-to-day practice. And our today's speaker is Dr. Haren Kumar, Associate Professor from Medical College, Agra. For further introduction and elaboration about him, now I will pass over to Dr. Ranjan Agarwal, who is the moderator for today. Dr. Ranjan Agarwal needs no introduction. We all know him as editor-in-chief of Indian Journal of Pathology and Microbiology. So I hand over to Ranjan to introduce Dr. Haren and start the proceedings.
A very good evening to one and all. Dr. Haren is a good academician, and I have been knowing him since many years now. Most important characteristic of Dr. Haren is he's a very good person, and you always find him whenever you need him. Academic-wise, he is presently working as an associate professor at SN Medical College, Agra. He passed out his MD from Kasturba Medical College in 2008, Mangalore. Presently, he is the joint secretary of our biggest association, IAPM. He is life member of many professional bodies, and he has a good number of publications to his credit. He is a good organizer, and he has conducted many IAPM seminars and under the UP chapter. And I have been giving him company as a co-examiner in many of the universities. And most important, what I find him is he starts teaching himself there also, interacting with students in spite of being busy with taking the Viva Voce. So now I now invite Dr. Haren to deliver his lecture, which is on mediators of inflammation, mechanism, and resolution. Dr. Haren, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for kind words. And good evening, everyone. It is first of all, I would like to thank Professor Batsala Madam and Dr. Ashranti Ma'am for giving me this opportunity, and Ranjan sir for supporting me to get this topic. And it is my privilege to speak on our basic topic, mediators of inflammation, mechanism, and resolution. Though it's a little complex topic, but I'll try to just explain. Let's see how it goes. So I'll start my talk. I've broadly categorized my talk in these broad headings, like definition, general features, types of inflammation. Before going to mediators, I'll just quickly go through the types, mechanism of inflammation in short, then I'll go to mediators and resolution and anti-inflammatory drugs. In between, I have kept some questions so that the students can be kept involved during the session, because otherwise it may be monotonous talk. So there are a few questions in between. So students can answer in the chat box. It can be like the moderator can tell us what they have answered. So Ranjan sir, please keep on telling us about the answers, because I have made the full screen, so I cannot see the chat box during this. So please. Now I'll start with the definition of inflammation. It's a response of vascularized tissues to infections and damaged tissues that brings cells and molecules of hosts defense from the circulation to the sites where they are needed in order to eliminate the offending agents. So basically, fundamentally, it's a protective mechanism that is essential for survival. It serves to rid the host of both from the initial cause of injury, like microbes and toxins, and consequences of such injury, like necrotic cells and necrotic tissues. So if there is no inflammation, what will happen without inflammation? Infections will go unchecked. There will be a widespread disseminated infection which will lead to the fascias, and wounds will never heal. Injured organs might remain permanent festering sores. And the typical, so before going into the further, I'll just quickly go through the series of sequences of events which happens during this inflammation. The offending agent is recognized by the host cells and molecules which are the resident of the and the tissue extracellular matrix, and these leukocytes and plasma cells are recruited to the site of injury from the blood vessels to the various series of events which I discuss in short in coming slides. And leukocytes and proteins are activated, which were like in inactive, some proteins are already present in complement, proteins are already present in inactive forms. They are activated and they work together to destroy and eliminate the offending substances. And the reaction is, after the offending agent is removed, reaction is controlled and terminated, and the damaged tissue is repaired. So this is just what we saw. These are some resident cells, macrophages, the mast cells, which recognizes the foreign invaders, the microorganisms, and they will send signals. They will try to engulf these things, and they will release some mediators which will recruit the leukocytes. Initially, the first cells are to be recruited as the neutrophils, then followed by the other cells. So then they will eliminate the microbes, and then ultimately they will repair. So there are basically two types of inflammation: acute and chronic. Onset, we can differentiate based on the onset and other features. Like onset in acute is only for a few minutes to hours, which lasts for a few hours to days. Whereas in chronic inflammation, it is from days to years. Cellular infiltrate in case of acute inflammation is mainly neutrophils along with protein exudates. Whereas in chronic inflammation, main cells are involved are macrophages and lymphocytes. Tissue injury and fibrosis in case of acute inflammation is usually mild and self-limited. And in case of chronic, it's often severe and progressive in nature. And there's a proliferation of blood vessels, fibrosis, and tissue necrosis. So these are this table shows some examples of some diseases, inflammatory reactions, like in case of acute respiratory distress syndrome, neutrophils are mainly involved. As in asthma, eosinophils are involved in IgE antibodies. In case of repeated attacks of asthma, it is classified in chronic also. And in glomerular arthritis, antibodies and complements are mainly involved in destruction of the glomerulobasement membrane and other structures. And neutrophils and monocytes are involved there. Septic shock, cytokines are widely released in abundance. So there is this widespread inflammation throughout the body. And in case of chronic, arthritis, lymphocytes, and macrophages are the main cells involved in that. And atherosclerosis, macrophages and lymphocytes. Whereas in case of pulmonary fibrosis, the macrophages and the fibroblasts. Causes, quickly I'll go to the causes of inflammation. First and foremost is the infections, which may be either bacterial, viral, fungal, parasitic, or microbial toxins. But different pathogens elicit the various inflammatory response, like from mild to a little inflammation, which lasts a very short duration, and is either minimal or no damage, residual damage, or to the severe inflammatory reactions, which can be fatal to the patients, or it can be a chronic inflammation based on the underlying pathogen. And tissue necrosis elicits inflammation regardless of the cause of cell death. And like ischemia, in ischemia, there is a less of blood flow in the which causes the in case of myocardial and cardiac muscle, it causes the myocardial infarction. And trauma, it is a sprain and contusions. Chemical agents like poisons or things are also cause of tissue necrosis. Irradiation, thermal extremes of the heat and cold. Thermal extremes of heat is the burns, and cold is the frostbite. Like third one is the foreign bodies foreign bodies like splinter, dirt, and suture, they may also elicit the inflammation by themselves, or they carry the microbes along with it. And the endogenous substances, like they can be also can be potentially harmful, like urate crystals are deposited in gout, cholesterol in atherosclerosis, and lipid in obesity-associated metabolic syndromes. Immune reactions, which are also known as hypersensitivity reaction, in which normally the protective immune system is damages own tissue, is called autoimmune diseases, and inflammation is a major cause of a tissue injury in autoimmune diseases and allergies. So here, stimuli for the, in case of immune reaction, stimuli for inflammatory responses like against the self antigen or the environmental antigens cannot be eliminated, and they tend to be persistent and they are difficult to cure. And they are often associated with the chronic inflammation, and which is the most important cause of morbidity and mortality. So this inflammation is induced by the cytokines produced by T lymphocytes and other cells which are involved in the inflammation. So let's see what are the cardinal signs of symptoms. So I'll ask one question before going further to the PGs who are attending here. What are the Celsus signs of inflammation? So out of these, one is not a Celsus sign. Celsus was a Roman writer of first century who listed four cardinal signs of inflammation. And followed by the 19th century, fifth sign was added by Rudolf Virchow, which was, I'll tell you in the coming slides, I don't want to. Sir, can you, have you got any response for this? Any answer?
Dr. Lalit and Dr. Khekri have given cyanosis.
Okay, sir. Yeah, it's the correct answer. This cyanosis is not a Celsus sign. These are the Celsus signs. First four, calor means heat, rubor means redness, tumor means swelling, and dolor means pain. These are the first four cardinal signs which were given by Celsus, Roman writer Celsus, in first century AD. And this fifth sign was added by 19th century by Rudolf Virchow, which is a functionalism, means loss of function. Next question, I guess, okay, this is the answer of the first question, cyanosis. Yeah, yeah, right. And next question is, rubor in inflammation is due to dilatation of arterioles, increased vascular permeability, increased viscosity of blood, or edema? Yes. So these five cardinal signs are the, like redness and heat are because of increased blood flow due to the vascular dilatation, and edema is because of increased permeability, and pain is because of certain chemical mediators like neuropeptides like substance P stimulate the sensory nerve endings giving rise to pain, and nerves are also stimulated by stretching or edema, and pain and swelling results in the loss of function. So answer is dilatation of arterioles. So, before going further, we discuss the nomenclature, how this inflammation is termed. If we use a tissue name with the suffix of itis, like if inflammation pancreas, pancreatitis, meningitis, pericarditis, or arthritis. These are the infections which we add the tissue name and the itis. Next question, first to appear in acute inflammation is vasodilatation. Before going further, let's see how they have read something, because people, the PGs ignore these basic topics. Increase vascular permeability, vasoconstriction, decrease vascular permeability. So in mechanism of acute inflammation, there is an alteration of the vascular caliber leading to vasodilatation, which leads to increased blood flow. But there may be transient vasoconstriction before that. So changes in microvasculature leads to increased permeability of plasma proteins and cells, and finally immigration of leukocytes from the microcirculation. and leukocyte activation, which leads to the elimination of pending agent. So answer is the first is vasodilation. However, sometimes we need the transient vasoconstriction also in some cases. So this picture shows, upper one shows the normal vasculature. It's a capillary bed at the arterial, and this is the normal resting capillary bed and showing there's no evidence of inflammation. Lower picture shows like they have this vasodilatation and increased neutrophils in the extracellular matrix and the deposition of fibrin and other plasma proteins leading to edema because of edema. And this shows the expansion of the capillary bed, which is a dilatation of that bed. So hallmark of acute inflammation is increased vascular permeability and edema, and followed by the main neutral and inflammatory cells are the neutrophils. So the hallmark is edema and increased vascular permeability. So this I've already discussed, and this steps rolling when adhesion migration I'll discuss in next picture. Before going to that, I'll just quickly go through discuss about what is the difference, how the transudate is formed or exudate is formed, and what are the differences between them. So normally, this blue arrow shows the hydrostatic pressure at the arterial end, which is around 32 mm of Hg, and the colloidal osmotic pressure is shown by the green arrow, which is around 25 mm of mercury, and mean colloidal pressure, mean capillary the pressure is around 25. Mean oncotic pressure is 25. So there is usually in case of resting condition, usually there is no fluid transport across these blood vessels because of it is almost equal to the mean capillary pressure. Whereas what happens in transudate, there is an increased hydrostatic pressure either because of venous outflow obstruction in case of congestive heart failure or because of decreased oncotic colloidal osmotic pressure because of either decreased protein synthesis in case of liver disease or increased protein loss in case of kidney diseases. So these transudates will have low protein content, low specific gravity, and only few cells may be seen.
Sorry, Dr. Harin, your voice is breaking. Your voice is not very clear.
Is there any background noise there, like fans?
Something is there. Voice is not coming very clearly.
Okay.
Yeah, some crick crick is coming.
Okay, just check it again.
So let's see. Restrict my movements, maybe some movements are there, so I'll restrict my movements. And in case of exudate, because of inflammation, vasodilatation and stasis and outpouring of the fluid from the intravascular compartment to extravascular compartment, which leads to the exudates have high protein content along with high specific gravity, and they have more cells as compared to transudate and QR along with the few RBCs. So these are neutrophils are the first, as I already told, first cells which are recruited at the site of inflammation. And this movement further leads to the extravasation of leukocytes in the coordinated fashion by margination, rolling, adhesion, transmigration, and chemotaxis, which is shown normally. Before going to that, I'll show the normal blood flow in the vessels. Normally, the RBCs are confined into the central axis, displacing leukocytes with the wall of vessels. When blood flow is slowed in case of inflammation, more white blood cells assume peripheral position along with endothelial surface. So this process is known as margination. So further, as these cells are activated and the chemokine is cytokines stimulate pre-selectin and E-selectin, and after margination, when these cells, the leukocytes will come into the contact with the leukocyte, they will start attaching with these low affinity bonds. Initially, there is a low affinity bonds, initially they will attach and detach and keep on rolling along the endothelial surface. Finally, an integration activation occurs by the chemokines, which stimulate the high affinity stable bonds. So there is a firm and stable adhesion occurs. And after this, these inflammatory cells are transmitted through the endothelial cells by forming the, they insert the pseudopores through the into the endothelial cell junctions, and they squeeze through into the extravascular space. And after coming out from the intravascular space to the extravascular space, these cells move towards the site of injury, because then stimulus was given and they have transmigrated. There's a slight delay in the, they have moved slightly away from the actual site of injury. So this, then from here, from where they have transmigrated from the blood vessels, from the intercellular compartment, they will move at the site of injury along the chemical gradient, which is known as chemotaxis. And here, these molecules like PCAM, platelet adhesin, endothelial cell adhesin molecules, which is CD30 immunoglobulin, which is CD31, as a predominant help in the transmigration. So after this, they will be, these neutrophils and macrophages will function to eliminate the pathogens by phagocytosis of pathogen, whatever the pathogen or noxious agent is there, and release of bactericidal and cytotoxic molecules to kill them, these things. So phagocytosis involves the three distinct steps. First of all, they will be recognized by the receptors, specific receptors, and they will be engulfment and fusion, they will be engulfed, and they engulf within the phagosomes with the ingested microsomes, and with lysosomes which are already present within the cells, they will come in contact with the phagosome, and they will fuse together to form phagolysosomes. Okay, and this killing and degradation mainly affects to the generation of oxygen free radicals and the their halogenation. So this, they will destroy these microorganisms. So I'll just close one more question, because it's related to what I'm going through. The Chedid-Egassi syndrome is characterized by following except. It's an autosomal recessive disorder, mutation in the LIT gene, oculocutaneous albinism is seen, and effective phagolysosome formation.
Yeah, answer has
answer
come.
Is
D.
D
has come.
D.
Answer D.
D. Yeah, it is a D, because there is no effective. It is a defective regular. They are unable to form this in case of Chedid-Egassi. I'll go into detail about the Chedid-Egassi. Yeah. So it's also some of the recessive disorder of all lysosomal granules containing cells with clinical features involving hematological and neurological. Mutated gene is LIT gene, which is a protein involved in the vascular formation and transport of proteins. If what happens here, it's a very impaired bacteriolysis because of failure of phagolysosome formation. And the diagnosis is confirmed by bone marrow smear showing giant inclusion bodies in the leukocyte precursor cells in the marrow. And here will show the on light microscopy, they will show evenly distributed regular melanin granules larger than those of found in the normal hairs. So the clinical feature, because of defective bacteriolysis, they present with the recurrent infections along with the abnormal the giant granules, peripheral nerve defects, mild mental retardation, oculocutaneous albinism, platelet dysfunction, and periodontal diseases, mild neutrophilia with normal immunoglobulin. So answer was defective phagolysosome formation, because there is no a fusion of this, so this was the wrong choice. So systemic effects of inflammation are fever, leukocytosis, and leukocytosis may be either with neutrophilic leukocytosis in case of the bacterial infection, which may have left shift because of severe bacterial infections, lymphocytosis in case of viral infections, eosinophilia, if it is there, then it points towards the allergy and parasitic infections. Acute phase proteins are produced in liver, they are increased, like fibrinogen, C-reactive protein, serum myelodysplastic proteins, which lead to increased ESR. Because why ESR is increased? Because normally red blood cells are, erythrocytes are negatively charged cells. and they repel each other. When there's increase in acute phase proteins, these they will shed the negative charge and they will come together, aggregate, and they ESR will be high in case of this. So ESR is used to detect the off-health inflammatory processes and to monitor the inflammatory response. So examples of acute inflammatory diseases and different origins are like, it may be because of allergic reaction, it may be ataptic ulcer, maybe pneumonia, or the sepsis. I'll just quickly go through the pictures. This picture shows the allergic reaction with the swelling of the larynx, various mediators, which we'll discuss in the coming slides. So this lot of swelling because of edema and other things. And next is the bacterial pneumonia. This X-ray chest shows the pneumonitic patch of consolidation in the lung, on which on microscopy shows the lung venuli are filled with the neutrophils and along with the edematous fluid, proteinaceous fluid, and the congested capillaries in the septal alveolar septa. Peptic ulcer is a local defect of mucosal lining produced by shedding of necrotic tissue, which are produced by imbalance between gastroduodenal defense mechanism and damaging forces. 70% of these ulcers are associated with the Helicobacter pylori infection, which initiates a strong inflammatory response. Septicemia with the DIC, disseminated intervascular coagulation due to meningococcal infection, which is caused by Neisseria, is invaded through the bloodstream, which leads to widespread vascular injury with the endothelial necrosis, thrombosis, perivascular hemorrhages. Here in this picture, hemorrhages are seen in skin, which can be seen in all organs. So before going further, so this is a question I'm asking little before, so that whether they have read or not, let's see. So resolution of inflammation is caused by TNF-alpha, human necrosis factor alpha, interleukin-1, CRP, TNF, interleukin-6, CRP, C-reactive protein, AGF, beta, interleukin-10, interleukin-1 receptor antagonist, and human necrosis factor gamma. Which of these is correct? Which one will have
answer? They have given C. C has the answer.
Yeah, it is the correct, because I'm going to in the next slide how this inflammatory process. Then I'll go to the mediators. So this was just a brief outline how the mechanism or underlying mechanism happens. So once whatever inflammation has to terminate when after the eradication of the offending agents, it should lead to the discontinuation of the inflammatory response. And the acute inflammatory cells, they have short lifespans, only for a few hours to one day. Most mediators are short-lived, so they are degraded immediately. And pro-inflammatory is a beta interleukin-1 can inhibit the production of the pro-inhibitory cytokines like human necrosis factor. So this was the correct answer. And arachidonic acid metabolism, like auxin and resolvins, are generated that have inflammatory, anti-inflammatory effect. Whether in arachidonic acid metabolism, there are many prostaglandins and leukotrienes which are pro-inflammatory. We'll discuss further, but we are discussing about the termination. So that's why I have mentioned here like auxins and resolvins, which have anti-inflammatory activity. So this was the correct answer. Now we'll go to the chemical mediators of inflammation. So basically, they are of two types, mainly the cell-derived, which are already either preformed and stored in the secretory granules or certain cells like histamine, stored in the mast cells, basophils and platelets. Serotonin is stored in the platelet granules, and or they can be newly synthesized within the cells from the other, like from the prostaglandins and leukotrienes are synthesized from the arachidonic acid. And these are the prostaglandins, leukotrienes, glucose activating factor, reactive oxygen species, nitric oxide, cytokines, neuropeptides. Cells, plasma derived, which are synthesized in the liver, they are already present within the plasma, but they are present in the inactive form. So when there is a stimulus, these inactive forms will be converted into the active forms, like activated C3A and C5A, which are NF-adapt toxins. C3B phagocytosis and C5B29 membrane complex, which I'll discuss in the next couple of slides. Factor 9 is also present there, which produces the bradykinin, which is a foot and toe dilatation. And coagulation fibrillated system is also involved. Yeah, I'll discuss in the next slides. And these mediators have specific characteristics because they perform biological activity by binding to the specific receptors on the target cells. They will not act anywhere. Like they, if they are released, so they will not, so they to act some, to bring out their action, they need certain targets, specific targets on the target cells. And they have direct, some of them, those have direct enzymic activities like lysosomal enzymes that, and or mediate of oxidative damage through oxygen metabolites. Once activated and released from the cells, they most are short-lived and quickly decay and inactivated by the enzymes or inhibited. So there's a checks and balances that regulate the mediator action. Okay, so we'll see in the coming slides later. Like this picture shows beautiful interrelationship between the four plasma mediator systems, which are triggered by the activation of the factor 12, which is usually present in the plasma as an active form. When it is activated, so then these four systems will learn. Like in through intrinsic pathway of clotting cascade, with thrombin is formed by through the various steps. This thrombin induces the inflammation by binding to the protein activated receptors, mainly the type 1, protein activated receptor 1 on platelet, endothelium, smooth muscles and other cells. Whereas by through these kinase cascade, we generate these pre-kinase kinases is converted into kallikrein, BLD kinases are formed and these things I'll discuss in the next picture. Yes. So this Hagman factor, activated Hagman factor will convert pre-kallikrein to kallikrein, which itself can convert inactive complement 5 into the activated complement 5. And this kallikrein will convert high molecular weight kinase to the bradykinin, which increases the vascular permeability and vasodilatation and causes the pain. And kallikrein is a potent activator for factor 12 and chemotactic. As I already told, it can directly convert C5 to activated distance. So before going to that, I'll come back again to this. So there's a beautiful interrelationship I already told, because once there's a clotting cascade is activated and there's a fibrin from this thrombin will further convert, apart from these inflammatory reactions, this will convert the fibrinogen into fibrin and it will form the clot. But it cannot go on, keep on going like thrombosis, otherwise it will be unopposed thrombosis. So in body, there's a, to check this, there's a fibrinolytic system is also activated. By this kallikrein, which convert plasminogen into the plasmin, which will degrade this fibrin into the fibrin degradation products. And this plasmin also converts inactive complement 3 to activated complement 3, which along with the C3A and C5A are NFR-like proxies. Okay, so before going to the complement system, last just one question. Complement having cell lytic properties are, which one is having the cell lytic activity? Membrane attack complex, C3B, C3A, C5A.
A, they have answered.
So membrane attack complex is the correct answer. So through the survival complement system, mainly the different pathways, like alternate pathway, classical pathway, or lectin pathway, they cleave the from the different pathway, they cleave the C3, inactive C3 into the C3A, which helps in the recruitment of the and activation of the leukocytes. And the other fraction, C3B, is involved in the phagocytosis, where the remaining complements, C5-9, they form the membrane attack complex, which are deposited on the surface of these microbes or the Hagman agent, and they will increase the permeability for the water and ice, so will cause the lysis of microbes, right? Forming the membrane attack complex. So this is the A is the correct answer. Yes. Now we move to the cellular mediators of cell-derived mediators. Cell-derived mediators, first was reformed chemical mediator, which I have already told, they were stored in the secretory granules of certain cells, like mast cells are the richest source of histamine, which are located in the connective tissue adjacent to the blood vessels. Degranulation occurs through the receptors of IgE, IgG, histamine releasing proteins, bacterial products, and anaphylactic toxins C3A and C5A, physical injury, cold, or heat. Most cells, mast cells are very important effector cells in the anaphylactic reactions. Whereas the platelets, this release of platelet activating factor leads to the serotonin release from the activated platelets, which are stored in the granules of the platelets. So next, now we'll move to the newly synthesized cell-derived mediators. Most important are the arachidonic acid metabolites, in which prostaglandins, leukotrienes, lipopsins are main mediators, and we'll discuss their role in the inflammation. So prostaglandins are and leukotrienes. So lipid metabolites, prostaglandins and leukotrienes are produced from the arachidonic acid, and which is arachidonic acid released from the membrane phospholipids through the activation of the cellular phospholipases, mainly phospholipase A2, by mechanical, chemical, physical stimuli, or by other mediators like activated C5A. And these arachidonic acid metabolites are called icosanoids because they are derived from the Greek term icosa, which means 20, and this arachidonic acid are 20 carbon fatty acids. So that's why they are called as icosanoids. And they are synthesized by major classes of enzymes, lipoxygenases and cyclooxygenases. So by cyclooxygenases, these prostaglandins, prostacyclins are produced, and by lipoxygenase pathway, leukotrienes and lipopsins are produced. Icosanoids bind to the G protein coupled receptors and can mediate virtually every step of inflammation. Next, so this is the picture showing the cell has the arachidonic acid is derived from the cell membrane phospholipids by these stimuli, which I've already discussed, with the action of phospholipase E2, mainly the phospholipase E2. So first I'll discuss the cyclooxygenase pathway and synthesis of the prostaglandins, which are produced by mainly the mast cells, macrophages, and other cells which are involved in the vascular or systemic reactions of the inflammation. So generally, there are two enzymes involved in the synthesis of the prostaglandins, cyclooxygenase 1 and cyclooxygenase 2. So these are responsible for production of the prostaglandins, which are involved in inflammation and homeostatic function. So COX-1 stimulates the prostaglandins, which stimulates both reaction, inflammation and homeostatic functions. Whereas COX-2 generates the prostaglandins, which are involved only in case of inflammation. And these nomenclature of these prostaglandins is they are coded by the letter like G, H, and B, E, F, and a number, subscript number, which indicates the double bond within this. So most important prostaglandins are which are involved in inflammation are PGE2, PGF2 alpha, PGI2 and thrombogen A2. PGB2, E2 and F2 alpha causes the vasodilatation and they potentiate the edema. And thrombogen A2 and prostacyclins, they have opposite effect of each other, and they are synthesized by different enzymes. Like thrombogen A2 is synthesized by platelets by the action of thrombogen synthetase enzyme, which promotes the platelet aggregation and vasoconstriction, whereas prostacycline, which is denoted as PGI2, is synthesized by the enzyme action of prostacycline synthetase, and which causes vasodilatation and inhibits the platelet aggregation. So they have opposite effects with each other. So that's why if there is an imbalance between these two, thrombogen and prostacyclines, which is when there's some increased chances of coronary or cerebral blood diseases like thrombosis or something. So we'll discuss in the along with anti-inflammatory drugs there. And after that, we move to the this side of the this figure, liquid which shows that leukotriene synthesis, the arachidonic acid converts like 5-hydroxy peroxy acetic acid. by action of 5-lipoacidases, which is further converted into the hydroxyecocetretinoic acid, which is a potent chemotactic along with the leukotriene B. And they are activators of neutrophil function responses like aggregation and adhesion of the leukocytes, generation of the free radicals and release of the lysosomal enzymes. And whereas other leukotrienes, which contain cysteinyl containing leukotrienes like leukotrienes C4, D4, and E4, they cause intense bronchoconstriction, bronchospasm, and increased vascular permeability. That's why they have role in case of bronchial asthma. So antagonists are needed for treatment of the asthma. And these leukotrienes are even more potent than the histamines in increasing vascular permeability and bronchospasm. So they have the strong, intense vasoconstriction in the spasm. This I have already one COX-1 and COX-2 is covered. Yes, this causes is covered. So now there are some leukotrienes which cannot be synthesized by these inflammatory cells, which they need to be interact with other cells, right? Cell-to-cell interaction. Like arachidonic acid can pass. So arachidonic acid to synthesize these this thing. Like it was shown here, like C4, leukotriene C4 cannot be synthesized in the neutrophils. So they will pass the intermediate compound which was synthesized from arachidonic acid, LTA4, by the action of 5-lipoxygenases to the platelets, which has this enzyme LTC4 synthetase, which will convert leukotriene A4 to C4, which is a potent inflammatory mediator. Whereas in contrast to this, opposite effect will have this leukotriene A4 is also involved in the synthesis of lipoxins, which have anti-inflammatory effect by the action of 12-lipoxygenases, which is important, which is present in the platelets. So before going to lipoxins, I'll ask load one more question. Like lipoxins synthesized from arachidonic acid act by decreased leukocyte migration, adhesion in chemotaxis. It will decrease all these things, or increase leukocyte migration, adhesion, chemotaxis. It will decrease all three aspects, vasoconstriction or increase vascular permeability. Any answer have you received, sir?
A,
yes, it is a correct answer, because lipoxins are inhibitors of inflammation. So their principal action is they inhibit leukocyte recruitment and other cellular components of inflammation. So they inhibit leukocyte chemotaxis and adhesion to the endothelium. So these lipoxins have inverse relationship between lipoxin production in the leukotrienes. When in the early inflammation, when level of leukotrienes is more, then lipoxin level is less. When during the termination of inflammation, inflammatory reaction, lipoxin level will increase and leukotriene level will decrease. So lipoxin may act as an endogenous negative regulator of leukotrienes and thus play an important role in resolution of inflammation. So this was the correct answer, A. Yes. So now I'll quickly discuss few anti-inflammatory drugs which acts by inhibiting the synthesis of eicosanoids, which are arachidonic acid derivatives. So cyclooxygenase inhibitors include the aspirin and other non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like ibuprofen and indomethacin. These cyclooxygenase inhibitors inhibit both cyclooxygenase 1 and 2 and thus inhibit prostaglandin synthesis. Aspirin does by the irreversibly acetylating and inactivating cyclooxygenases. And cyclooxygenase 1, as I've already discussed during the prostaglandin, is responsible for production of the prostaglandins, which are involved in both inflammation and homeostatic function like fluid and electrolyte balance in kidney and cytoproduction of GIT. Whereas COX-2 generates prostaglandins, which are involved in only in the inflammation. So selective COX-2 inhibitor should be anti-inflammatory without having the toxicities of the non-selective inhibitors such as gastric ulceration. But recently, results have raised some concerns that selective COX-2 inhibitors may increase the risk of cardiovascular and cerebrovascular events. So, which has led to the FDA has removed or withdrawn some drugs of these selective COX-2 inhibitors, which are the newer drugs from the USA. Because possible explanation for that is the COX-2 inhibitors impair the endothelial production of the prostacyclins, which I showed you in this figure, this prostacyclin. So selective COX-2 inhibitors will inhibit the production of the prostacyclin, which is a vasodilator and inhibitor of the platelet aggregation, whereas leaving intact the effect of thromboxane, which will cause vasoconstriction and this and more of platelet aggregation. So leaving intact this unopposed action of the thromboxane E2. So this will cause the possible explanation for arterial thrombosis. Next one is lipoxygenase inhibitors or leukotriene receptor inhibitors. These NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, do not affect the lipoxygenase enzyme. So the new inhibitors have been developed. They inhibit the leukotriene production, both are used receptor inhibitors, and these lipoxygenase inhibitors are used in the treatment of the asthma. Because the receptor inhibitors will prevent action of leukotrienes even if they are there. And broad spectrum inhibitors like corticosteroids have powerful anti-inflammatory agent which acts by reducing the transcription of the genes encoding the COX-2 or phospholipase A2, which was important in the synthesis of like arachidonic acid synthesis from the membrane phospholipids. So another interesting approach in manipulating the inflammatory responses by modifying the intake and content of the dietary lipid by increasing the consumption of the fish oil. Polyunsaturated fatty acids in fish oil serve as a poor substrate for conversion of the active metabolites of both cyclooxygenase and lipoxygenase pathway, whereas it is an excellent substrate for production of anti-inflammatory lipid products called resolvins. So now we move to further other mediators of mediosynthesized with mediators. There are many other cell-derived mediators, which are interleukin-1, tumor necrosis factor. They have local effects and systemic effects. And local effects, tumor necrosis factor and interleukin-1 will increase the expression of the adhesion molecules, so recruitment of the cells at the site of injury, and the more they will induce these cells to secrete more chemokines. And systemic effect, they will have fever and more of acute phase proteins and more of leukocyte production, which I'll discuss in one case also. And the other systemic effect will be because of low output, increased thrombus formation, and insulin resistance. So in this picture, we can see here, these leukocytes results from the direct effect of interleukin-1 and interleukin-6 on marrow. So this the more of leukocyte production. So this may cause, if there is an exaggeration of this reaction, they may cause this granulocytosis or leukocytosis with left shift of neutrophilic population. In this picture is a mild to moderate shift. There are many mature neutrophils along with some precursor forms, precursor forms like myelocytes and some bank forms, and they probably have some toxic granulation also. This picture shows the more severe left shift with the more immature cells, predominantly immature cells. So this can result in leukemic reaction because of very immature precursor cells are released from the marrow, and even the cell counts may be more than 25 to 30,000. This is a very interesting one, interleukin-6, which has recently gained very popularity during the COVID time, which is secreted from T cells, macrophages, endothelial cells, and fibroblasts, and targets are neutrophils, B cells, T cells, basophils, and eosinophils. cytokine storm was a main discussion during our COVID postings, which was interesting finding in COVID-19 patients. It is due to the high levels of interleukin 6, which were associated with pulmonary inflammation and extensive lung damage, and even along with the multiple organ failure. And in after interleukin 6 activation, acute phase will be proteins like CRP, serum amyloid-associated proteins, fibrinogen, and haptoglobins are increased in initial stages of inflammation. And it was noticed that humanized monoclonal antibody against interleukin 6 receptor, tocilizumab, was used in COVID-19 patients based on the cytokine blocking property of this. So this drug was used during the treatment when the cytokine interleukin 6 levels were very high. The next mediator is the chemokines, which are very small proteins produced by a number of different cells, and they act as a primary as a chemoattractant and WBC activators. So they function by the recruitment of the polymorphonuclear cells, monocytes, eosinophils, basophils, and they increase by the WBC adhesion to endothelium, and they function binding through the G protein coupled receptors. They are of four types, major four groups. CXC is also known as alpha chemokines, where one amino acid residue separating the first two cysteine conserved residues. And they mainly act on the neutrophils, and the main example for this is interleukin 8. Here, CC chemokine, which is also known as beta chemokines, are the first, in which their first two cysteine residues reside adjacent to each other without any amino acid in between, and they attract all other leukocytes except the neutrophils. C chemokines are also known as the gamma chemokines, and they lack the first and third cysteine residues of the four conserved cysteine molecules, and they are relatively specific for the lymphocytes. And fourth one is the CXCC, where the three amino acids are present between the two cysteine molecules, and they are their only known member is the fractalkine, and they promote the adhesion of monocytes in T cells. As I've already told, these mediates their action by binding to the seven transmembrane G protein coupled receptors. Next mediator is the nitric oxide, which nitric oxide is produced from the L-arginine, and which causes vasodilatation, and nitric oxide free radicals are toxic to the microbial and mammalian cells, so they have microvascular effect, and thus nitric oxide is a mediator of host defense against the infections. Now, this is very important. Oxygen-derived free radicals like superoxide ions, hydrogen peroxide, or hydroxyl ions are released extracellularly from the WBC after phagocytosis, exposure to chemotactic agents or immune reactions. They can also combine with the nitric oxide to form reactive nitrogen intermediates. These can cause endothelial cell damages, inactivation of antiproteases, leading to unopposed protease activity by causing the increased destruction of extracellular matrix, or they can also cause injury to multiple cell types. So resulting damage depends on the status of anti-free radical system which is present in the body, which is by creating, because when the serum tissue fluid in hospitals possesses the antioxidant mechanisms, which protects against these harmful oxygen-derived free radicals. So these include antioxidants, include superoxide dismutases, catalases, glutathione peroxidases, thermoplasmin, transferrins. So there's the influence of oxygen-derived free radicals in any given inflammatory reaction depend on the balance between production and inactivation of these metabolites by cells and tissues. So next question is, increased capillary permeability is caused by all of the following except anaphylactoxins, 5-hydroxytryptamine, renin, or histamine. So it's a renin. Renin is a wrong answer. Next question is, in cellular events of inflammation, all are seen except complements involved in the chemotaxis, intracellular adhesion molecules leads to adhesion of leukocytes, PKM leads to the activation of leukocytes and selectins and rolling. This is the wrong option.
C answer. They have given C.
Yes. So PKM is not, it's mainly helps in the transmigration of leukocytes across the, through the interendothelial junctions. So this will happen to the transmigration of leukocytes than the, not in the activation of leukocytes. Yes, it's a C. So for finally, acute, what are the outcomes of resolution? So outcomes of the acute inflammation, it may be either resolute. So resolution may occur like after clearing of all injurious stimuli and clearance of mediators because they are short-lived, and acute inflammatory cells because they are also short-lived. The neutrophils have few hours to one day, half-life few hours to one day, and replacement of injured cells, and they regain the normal function. Or they may lead to the fibrosis because of fibrosis, and it leads to the loss of function, or if there is a persistent injury, ongoing inflammation due to autoimmune diseases or chronic infection, this will go, it may end up into the chronic inflammatory conditions, which have one and more of mononuclear cell infiltrate, angiogenesis, and scar formation. So I'll quickly summarize the mediators which we have discussed. So I think I'm in time. So vasoconstriction is caused by the thromboxane A2. Vasodilatation is caused by histamine and prostaglandins. Increased vascular permeability by the histamine, serotonin, anaphylactic toxins like activated complement 3 and 5, bradykinin, leukotriene C4, D4, E4, and the platelet restricting factor. And chemotaxis and leukocyte recruitment is caused by the leukotriene B4, which is a potent chemotactic agent, human necrosis factor, interleukin-1, chemokines, bacterial products, and activated complement 3 and 5. Bronchospasm, intense bronchospasm was caused by, I already discussed, C4, D4, and E4. Fever, mediators involved are the interleukin-1, interleukin-6, and prostaglandins. In pain, prostaglandins, bradykinin, and substance P is involved, which is a neuropeptide, and tissue damage is caused by lysosomal enzymes or reactive oxidative species. So basically, inflammation, I'll summarize all these points. Inflammation is a beneficial host response to foreign invaders and necrotic cells. And main component of inflammation are vascular reaction and cellular response, which are activated by mediators, which are of two types, either cell-derived or plasma-derived. Steps of inflammatory response can be remembered by 5 R's. First is recognition of injurious agents, recruitment of the leukocyte, removal of agents, regulation of control of the response, and finally, repair of resolution of inflammation. Leukocytes can eliminate microbes and dead cells by phagocytosis. Destruction is caused by free radicals generated by activated leukocytes and lysosomal enzymes. And most mediators are short-lived and degrade immediately. These mediators perform biological activity by binding to specific receptors and target cells, which are these points are discussed. And anti-inflammatory cytokines can inhibit the production of pro-inflammatory cytokines. And lipoxins, arachidonic acid metabolites, lipoxin and resolvins have anti-inflammatory effects. These are my acknowledgments. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Harind.
Thank you, sir.
For a nice and elaborate. We have some questions. Dr. Nupur Kaushik has asked, what is the stimulus for chemotaxis?
Okay, chemotaxis is stimulus. There are some chemoattractants, which may be either exogenous or endogenous. Exogenous are bacterial products like N-formyl, methionyl peptides, and endogenous may be the cytokines which are produced, chemokines like interleukin-8, and NFRF toxins like activated C5, or leukotrienes which we discussed during the leukotrien synthesis. Leukotriene B4 is a potent chemoattractant, endogenous chemoattractant.
Okay. One more question is from Dr. Lalit. Role of complement in PNH. Although you have completed and discussed complement, he has a specific role. He wants to know about the role of complement in PNH.
Okay, sir. Complement in PNH, I've not discussed during the discussion. There are mainly the two proteins are involved in this. They are decay activating factors and CD59. So these are linked to the like plasma membrane by GPI anchors, and decay activation factor prevents this prevents the formation of the C3 convertase. So this will prevent the further activation of the complement 3. And CD59 inhibits the formation of the membrane attack complex. So if these things are, there is a deficiency of these enzymes, so there will be increased complement mediated cell lysis, which will cause RBC lysis in case of PNH.
Okay. We have one more question from Dr. P.K. Bhattacharya. Discuss the role of statin in inflammation and sepsis.
What's it?
Role of statin in inflammation and sepsis.
Statin.
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 I have not heard. Sorry.
Okay, probably he wants to deal with the treatment part.
Treatment part, only the anti-inflammatory effect, this statin type part. This
Any more questions from the audience or the panelists, please?
Dr. Ranjan, there is one more question from P.K. Bhattacharya also. Role of MAP kinase, JAK-STAT, NF-KB in cytokine storm. P.K. Bhattacharya. Dr. Haren? MAP kinase, JAK-STAT, NF-KB in cytokine storm.
Cytokine storm, it was only the dispatch I have read, because of otherwise in our textbook it was not given much of the about the
I just would like to comment that it is in an upcoming phase. I don't think so. It has yet been proved and the treatment has been started.
Whatever I mentioned today about interleukin 6 was taken from some journals and it is not in our external textbook.
This is an upcoming in the treatment part, especially with the second wave of COVID coming around. So this is the marker which is coming up. But it is still in the research phase as much as I know. Even.
Another one is there from Dr. Lalit Kumar. What are the role of complement system in PNH?
That he has already discussed. Yes,
he has discussed.
Yeah.
Okay. And this you told, no? From Nupur Kausik?
Yes, stimulus for chemotaxis. He has already dealt with.
Okay.
I think
I've finished in
time.
No, definitely it was very within time, Dr. Arin. Any panelists, any comments or suggestions or anything else? Ma'am?
Yes, Harin, your talk was very well. You have put in a nutshell a vast topic. It is really very vast.
Very
vast. If I say I accept, I myself was afraid of this topic always as a UG, as a PG, for teaching when we have to prepare the lecture for information.
Actually, so many cycles are there.
Make it concise to finish it in 2 and 3 lectures, whereas it is such an important, all the roles of these cytokines, complements, so many systems, they are working together. And based on this, the treatment also we have to decide based on the action of these so many chemical substance, or you can say reactants, which are there and which are interacting with each other. So I think you are well within the time and you covered it very well, making a short summary and discussing the important topics. And the another thing was that you put the questions in between. So all the delegates were...
Yes.
They were interacting.
That was the interesting part.
The best part.
Yeah.
that was very nice that way because they were interacting, which is
good. Number of answers were coming up.
Topics. In fact, I was afraid of
we are mostly scared of the mediators. Mediators are exams is the most scary part.
Every day a new mediator is coming. Every day the new drug is coming because which is active against another mediator. As you say, for anti-inflammatory drugs, starting from aspirin, which we started, and now the newer drugs are coming. So inflammation has a very important role in patients. It is not a typical scientific topic. It has a basic role in patients' diagnosis, patients' management, pathogenesis of various neoplasms. Like even for myeloma, we start with the role of interleukin-6 and then subsequent the pathogenesis goes on. So this was a very important topic covered very well by Haren, and you were well within time.
And thank you, ma'am. In fact, I am having personal problem with this inflammation because my son is having repeated bouts of recurrent pancreatitis. So even a few days back he had the recurrence, and I was afraid whether I could deliver today's talk or not. But fortunately, day before yesterday, he recovered, and today I am here in front of you all.
Yes.
And probably tomorrow I am going to Medanta for his consultation because why this recurrence? Yes. Because I have shown so many places.
Achha.
Comment from other panelists.
We have other panelists like Asim sir, Dr. Pradeep, and Langiver sir also is there. Langiver sir, please unmute sir and tell something.
I am to speak something also.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Sir, please.
Yes, sir.
Tell. Hello, Dr. Haren.
Sir, good evening, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Very well done.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Now, this lecture was for undergraduate or postgraduate?
For both. For the faculties, sir.
Postgraduate.
Now, what happens in new CBME? This is the type we have to teach to the undergraduate student.
Yes.
True or not? True or not?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, sir.
Now, I was all the time thinking that all these terminologies, they are listening for the first time. So, in your lecture, those were not explained. All terminology, they don't know inflammation. They did not know who is Celsus. And then immediately your
rocket question was there.
I think you have done a good job. You have done a good job. But then you have to slightly improve. Because for undergraduate, I'm telling you.
Yes, sir.
Example of unusual diseases. And number two, what is the resource of this? One, I could identify Robbins.
Robbins.
Yes. Because I did not know from where.
Predominantly, the resource is Robbins, and along with some pictures from some journals. And some case.
I found that they were different from Robbins. Yes. And third, did you question? Did you coin yourself or you have picked up from somewhere?
No, sir, I have not coined. These were picked up from somewhere, sir. No.
Okay.
Yes, sir, very frankly, sir.
They were nice questions.
They were not my questions. This way I have put.
So you give us a source of that question from where we have picked up.
That is the PG guys.
PG preparation.
PG preparation guys are there and that these questions are given.
I'm mainly worried with UG. Because we are now teaching to the undergraduate students.
Yes, sir. Where we are teaching
this? Show them real information.
So this lecture is there for undergraduates. We take for in three sessions, 1 hour session. So for 3 hours. So initially we describe the basics in detail. Then we go to the inflammation. But sir, today topic
means to prepare mediators. You have done a great job.
Thank you, sir.
You have done a great job in the shortest time.
Great job.
And I may send you some mail for some resource materials. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now, other panelists.
Dr. Siddharth, hello. Your comments. Mahanti sir is there.
Yes. shall I give my comment?
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah.
Yes.
So when I was hearing this lecture, I just remembering my third year class when you started with information. Keller, Ruber, Dollar, Tumor, and Functional Isha. So I was got interested from those three words because we remember the pathology base, we start with this. And he says, he has presented in a very difficult and complicated subject in a very concise manner and simple manner. So this is quite nice. I enjoy the lecture. I congratulate Dr. Harendra Kumar
for
giving
you.
Us the opportunity to revise and remember our past. I left medical college, teaching general pathology 22 years back. So I enjoyed your lecture. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very
thank
much.
You, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for kind words.
Now, anyone else? Vasim sir and Pradeep.
Siddharth sir and Vasim sir is here. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Dr. Haren. Ashim, you please tell first.
Sir, unmute.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Haren, for this basic aspects, which at least I don't listen too often. I just wanted to ask you one question because I do liver pathology most of the time. So viral hepatitis, when it damages the hepatocyte, virus doesn't have any cytopathic effect. In fact, the body's immune system destroys. Is it different from the usual bacterial infections? Even though with the other viral like herpes simplex, they have a also direct cytopathic effect. Only I'm talking of immunocompetent individuals.
I think Siddharth
is here, who is a
liver specialist. He can probably discuss
the question.
No. This is always my query. Why in viral hepatitis, virus cannot, in an immunocompetent individual, of course, in immunosuppressed, they have a direct cytopathic effect. But they take, I don't know how do they take the help of body's immune system to destroy the hepatocytes?
No, actually, many viral infections, because they cannot multiply themselves, so if they cause cytopathic effect, they cannot use the cellular DNA or RNA because they don't have the system for proliferation. And living things have to live and multiply. And their basic thing is that they have to use some other cellular mechanism, some other cell's DNA or RNA to multiply. So most of the viruses, they avoid having a cytopathic effect on the cell. If they damage the cell, then they cannot survive. And so once they enter the cell, however, many of their proteins get expressed on the surface and the immune system has to take care of it. If either the antibodies or the T cells by cytotoxicity, they will recognize the antigen and kill, or the NK cells in which by usual mechanism is the kiss of death. They need not be primed before. In fact, most of the vaccines now in which they are giving this viral RNA and DNA, there are two mRNA vaccines and one DNA vaccines. They're using the same thing. They're introducing the RNA or DNA into the cells. They are producing proteins similar to the spike proteins, which are getting exposed. And then, of course, the body is getting producing the antibodies accordingly. And even they say that if you put the inactivated entire cell, in addition to the spike protein, it will produce other proteins. Well, anyway, these are all theoretical at this moment, this have to be proven. So in viral hepatitis, like many other viruses, encephalitis and others, they do not want to destroy the cell itself. They require the cellular DNA and RNA to produce. So less of cytopathic. And then, of course, but the body has to remove them. So whenever the it is exposed on the surface, viral hepatitis. And the other thing is, Dr. Haren, that question on statins. Statins are considered to be anti-inflammatory. So they say that statins are anti-inflammatory. So that is perhaps the question. You have taken a wonderful lecture. Thank you very much. And as this inflammation is an evergreen topic for all
at every time.
And it's changing. Every year it is changing more and more. And it's becoming more and more difficult to teach undergraduates, as Dr. Lanchavar said. Yes. It is one of the basic processes of pathology. Everybody should know. Anybody who enters the medical college should come out with the understanding of inflammation. So, you have done, as you said, you have a lot of things you had to condense in 1 hour. You have done a wonderful job. Thank you so much. It's been nice. And I hope, Dr. Asaranthi, with your registration and certification, more people join today.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Dr.
Pradeep
there?
Yeah.
Yeah, so waiting for your comments.
Yeah, I am suffering from pyrexia of Harendra origin. Because I think the mediators are so many, and it may not be very practical for not only undergraduates, but even for postgraduates to remember. So the basic take-home message should be that you have certain categories which play an important role in one or more aspects of that inflammatory process. So at least they should remember the main categories rather than all the mechanisms which are enlisted in the book. And, you know, even as examiners, we should not expect them to, you know, put out all this. So if they basically understand what is happening and how all this would be important, even from the clinical and from the treatment point of view, I think our job's done that way.
Yes, Dr. Vaidheeshwar, even if they give a wrong answer, sometimes you also do not know.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. So if you put too much of thrust on all this, we might ask some question, we might get a wrong answer, and we'll assume it is the right one.
Yes.
It depends on how effective that candidate is and how confidently he's telling that in front of you.
Yeah.
Therefore, when you are teaching in general pathology section to UGs, I think inflammation is the most difficult chapter. How to summarize it and give them what message you want to give them. Because it is a very vast chapter and you have to summarize and want to give them which is most important, which is clinically also relevant. So I think with new course also, they have given some competencies, but still it will be very difficult to completely give them what is important. So we have to see that they should at least know the groups of chemical mediators, broad groups. I think that is also sufficient. We don't know the broad groups which are predicated, stimulated, which are the changes affecting the neutrophils, etc. So I think that is sufficient for UGs, which will be clinically relevant later on.
Now, actually, as Dr. Vaidheeshwar has rightly pointed out, and Madam has told now, that we have to tell them the principles and they have to understand the process. For example, redness, edema and other things. So when there is an inflammatory process, some furuncle or something, they should be able to identify. This is an inflammatory process. Secondly, they should know the broad outline so that what drug to give, they will understand.
Yes.
So this is mainly those things. And of course, now it's getting more complicated with interferon, this and that, which are also used for diagnostic C-reactive protein. This, yeah. So many.
No, I think we were lucky to pass. We were lucky to pass MBBS and MD at an early age because at that time there were only few mediators which we know.
Without knowing much.
Yes.
We wouldn't have, I do not know how many of us would have cleared the entrance test.
So we'll close the meeting now. Oh. Now next one we'll have this pig beds and minerals histomorphology distinction with special strength. Oh, it's a slide seminar. Next one will be a slide seminar.
Very good. Thank you.
Good.
Oh, and we are going to have...
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'm very happy. Many joined today as panelists. I'm very happy.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Haren. Very nice.
Thank you, Dr. Haren. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Good night. Good night.